Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the next session of SAP Online Academy classes. We will be having a 1 hour session. First 20 minutes, we will cover the topic. Then 10 minutes will be allotted for answering the questions in the Q&A session. Then the next 20 minutes will be allotted for the topic and final 10 minutes for Q&A. So participants, please note that you need to specify your doubts in the Q&A option. Today, the resource person for our session is Bindu S. Mani Ma'am, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, College of Engineering, Kidangur. She has completed her PhD in Computer Science from MG University, Kerala in 2017 in Digital Image Processing, and she has a teaching experience of more than 21 years in both UG and PG level. Her areas of interest include Digital Image Processing, Soft Computing and Machine Learning. Her paper has won the Best Paper Award in NCCSC 2011, and she has about 27 research publications in her name. I welcome you, ma'am, to this session. Over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. I would like to thank SAP coordinators too, especially Lakshmi, ma'am, as you sir, for giving me such an opportunity to interact with the entire students from Kerala. APJ Abdul Kalam Technological University. So, welcome dear students. We'll be seeing the next section of fourth module. We have covered CPU scheduling and the next section is deadlocks. Now, we'll be dealing with only the syllabus. It will be a syllabus oriented section only. The other portions we can take in we cannot take that in time, so we'll be dealing with only the syllabus oriented portions only. Now deadlocks sections will be dealt with the system model, deadlock characterization, method of handling deadlocks, deadlock prevention, deadlock avoidance, deadlock detection, recovery from the deadlock situation. So these are the contents which will be dealt in this deadlocks, but for this 1 hour session we'll be able to complete only one section of that one. So rest will be dealt in the other classes. So the objectives of this particular section is to have describe the deadlocks which will be used in the second options. You need a number of different methods for preventing or avoiding deadlocks in a computer system. So first we'll be describing what is a deadlock. And then we'll go for a different methods to prevent or avoid deadlocks. So we know that in your process or in your system, if we are dealing with only uniprocessor system, that is one processor only. So in that one, and during the multi-programming environment situation, you know that several processes will be there in your system. And these processes will be one by one executing, and during the execution it needs number of resources. So we are dealing with enough number of or n number of processes. That degree will be decided by the multiprogramming, and degree of n, you can say that there may be or there might be n processes inside your system. And with a finite number of resources, you have to execute the n number of processes. So there will be some competition between these processes, and some process may get the resource in time and some may be waiting. So if suppose a process P1 requests a resource, and if the resource is not at all available at that time, the process P1 will be entering into a waiting state. Now suppose you assume a situation in which the waiting process is never again able to change the state, that is the waiting state, because of the resources it has requested or held by other waiting process. Just suppose that P1 is requesting a resource R1, and this R1 is used or held by some other process P2, and P2 is in need of some other process and it is also waiting. So what happens is these processes will not be able to execute further, or it will be in the waiting state. So in that situation, these processes will be set into or set, will be set as in a deadlock situation. Just take the example of two trains coming in a, or crossing or coming in a single line, what will happen? It cannot move forward. That is, the first train will be stopping because the second one, if it is coming in the same line, cannot go forward. So both will be coming to a full stop, and neither shall start up again until the other has gone. So such a situation is actually called as a deadlock situation. Nothing can be executed further. Now, IS typically do not provide any deadlock prevention facilities. It gives the importance, or the programmers must ensure that they design deadlock-free programs. Now we'll see the situation. Suppose that process P1 and process P2 is executing. Now there are two resources, R1 and R2. R1 is assigned to P1 and P1 is waiting for a resource R2, and R2 is assigned to the process P2, and also this P2 is waiting for a resource R1. So in this situation, one resource is assigned to process P1 and it is waiting for other one, but that one is assigned to another one. So these two processes cannot execute or can't complete its execution because what it needs is not with them, it is assigned to some other. So both these processes won't be able to execute. So that means these two processes are coming into a situation of deadlock. So processes, when they try to access the same resource at the same time, one process must wait for the other to finish. So when the waiting process is still holding on another resource that the first needs before it can finish, deadlock situation occurs. Okay. Now we can see the same with another example. Suppose that these are the vehicles which are going in this direction, and these vehicles are going in this particular direction, and these are set of vehicles moving in this direction, and the vehicle in this direction are shown here. So here in this situation, suppose we start from here or start from any location, this vehicle can move to this side only after moving these vehicles. So that is situation. You see, this can move only if these vehicles move this side. So it is blocked here. These vehicles are blocked here because of this one not moving to this side. And these are also blocked. Why? Because these vehicles are not at all moving to this direction. And if they want to move, this must be moved in this direction. But unfortunately, this is also blocked because of this. So in this particular scenario, all the vehicles are coming to a situation where this waits for this one, and this waits for this one, and this waits for this one, and this is waiting for this. Likewise, you say that there is a circular wait is there. So in such situation, the set of all processes which is in a deadlock state, when every process in the set is waiting for an event, and that can be caused only by another process in the set. This is the situation. Now we'll see what is the system model, how you can model this one. You know, the system consists of resources, and these resources can be distributed among a number of competing processes. Now we suppose that there are some n processes, P1, P2, P3, etc. Pn processes are there, and their resources are R1, R2, etc. Rm, different types of resources. The types of resources can be physical resources, which may be CPU cycles, memory space, printers, tape drives, like that you have enough number of physical devices or physical resources. Then you have logical resources also, files, semaphores, mutex locks, like that you have logical resources also. So if you have R1, R2 and M such resources, that may be shared between the processes. So each resource type Ri has Wi instances. That means if you have two printers, you can say that there are two instances of resource type printer. You may have enough number of files also, semaphores, anything. So you can say that Wi is the number of instances with a type Ri. So whenever a process requests these resources, it can request any number of resources to carry out its task. We cannot say that a process will be in need of only one resource. Sometimes it can be more than one resource is needed for that one. So when the process needs to execute, it can request for any number of resources. Now, the only thing is the number of resources requested must not exceed total number of resources available in the system. Suppose you think there are five or three printers are there in your system, and you are asking for, or a process is asking for, four printers. So what happens? It cannot be processed. So the request must be the number which is less than the available number of resources. Now, whenever a process is executing, it will be using the resource. One by one, resource it will be using. There is an order in which they can be used. That is, first, the process must request a resource. And if it is not available, the process must wait for that resource to be free. And once the resource is allocated to that process, the process can operate on that resource. If you need a printer, you can, after allocating, you can print the details till the end of the content. After that, you have to release that resource. After printing, you may release. That is, process will release the resource after its need. Okay? Situation deadlock means processes never finish executing and the system resources are tied up, and it will prevent other jobs from starting. That means if two processes are executing and they are getting into a deadlock, these two processes will never finish until the deadlock situation is changed. And those resources which are carried or which are held by that process will be tied up there. It cannot be used by other processes. And then whenever you are starting with other process, it sometimes, if there are resources are not at all available, the newly created process cannot start itself. So this is the problem with the deadlock. So what you want to do is you want to identify a situation where deadlock will be occurring and how you can characterize this deadlock situation. The necessary conditions for a deadlock to occur is, you can say that deadlock can arise if four conditions hold simultaneously. And these are the four conditions. The first one is mutual exclusion. Second, hold and wait. Third, no preemption. And fourth one, circular wait. These are the four conditions. So if these four conditions simultaneously, then you can say that deadlock can arise in that system. So the first one, mutual exclusion. You know, we have seen what is mutually exclusive. That is, only one process at a time can use a resource. So if another process requests that resource, the requesting process must be delayed until the resource has been released. And here you see, in this situation, we have two processes, P1 and P2. Both P1 and P2 request for the resource R1. And see, R1 cannot be assigned to both these P1 and P2. It can only be allocated to either P1 or P2. So depending upon the situation and the request, we can say this one will be allocated to, you just think that it is allocated to P1. That is, R1 is allocated to P1. So what about P2? P2 must wait till R1 is released by P1. Then only R1 can be allocated to P2. So P2 will be in the waiting state. Now, one more thing, when you are saying that about the mutual exclusion, you must have a resource. Some resources are shareable and some resources are non-shareable. So, non-shareable means the printer cannot be shared among two processes simultaneously. But file can be, read-only file can be used simultaneously by two processes. So at least one resource must be held in your non-shareable mode. The next condition is hold and wait condition. Now we'll see what is hold and wait. A process must hold at least one resource and it must wait to acquire additional resources held by other processes. We see the situation. P1 is a process. P1 is holding R1. That means R1 is allocated to P1. And P1 is waiting for R2. And this R2 is being allocated to some other process, namely some P2 or P3. It can be allocated to some other one. And after release of that one, then only this process 1 will be able to receive or request allocate this R2. So hold and wait. It is holding one and it is waiting for some other R2 resource. So this is the case with hold and wait condition. Okay. Next we'll see no preemption. You know what is meant by preemption? While executing one process, it needs some resources and this resource is allocated to this process P1. And while it is executing, if some other process requests this R1, the process must not, P2 must not preempt this R1 from P1. That means the resource cannot be preempted. Then resource released by only voluntarily by the process holding it. That is after completion of the process or the necessity of P1, P1 will be releasing R1 and at that time only P2 or the requesting process can be requesting or allocating when can be given this process resource R1. Okay. So when it finishes its task, that will be released by P1 itself. So no other process can preempt the resource from P1 or the concerned process. So this is called no preemption. Okay. And the fourth condition is circular wait. You can say set of processes, let it be P0, P1, etc. up to PN of waiting processes. Okay. So P0 is waiting for a resource held by P1. And P1 is waiting for a resource held by P2. And P2 is waiting for a resource held by P3 and etc. We can say that suppose PN minus 1 is waiting for a resource held by PN and PN is waiting for a resource held by P0. So that means what? P1 P0 waiting for P1, P1 waiting for P2, P2 waiting for P3 and finally PN minus 1 waiting for PN and PN it will be waiting for P0. So you see that there will be a cycle or a circular wait will be there. P1 waiting for, here in the example, this example you have only four processes. P1 waiting for P2 and P2 waiting for a resource which is allocated by P3 and P3 is waiting for a resource which is already allocated to P4 and P4 is requesting or it is waiting for a resource which is already allocated to P1. So these all come in a circular wait. Okay. Or you can say that there is a circular chain of hold and wait condition. What you have said in the second one, you have seen that a hold. So circular chain of hold and wait is same. So you see this one, R1 is held by P1 and P2 is waiting for this R1. So this dotted line says that it is a, it is not at all allocated or it is a way in the request is maintained, it is not assigned. Is that clear? So these are the four conditions where you need a deadlock to, if you have four conditions simultaneously in your system, then you can say that some deadlock can occur in that such a situation or such a system. Now we'll see how you can describe a deadlock using a directed graph. You can say that system resource allocation graph will be able to describe a deadlock, or if you want to detect a deadlock, you can draw a system resource allocation graph and see whether deadlock has occurred or like that. Now, a system resource allocation means it is a graph contains vertices and edges, is it? So it will be a set of vertices V and a set of edges E. V is partitioned into two types of nodes. So you have the vertices, it contains two types of nodes. P is a set of processes, P1, P2, P3, etc. up to Pn processes are there. And R is a set consisting of all resources in the system, where R is equal to R1, R2, R3, etc. Rm. So there are n processes and m resources inside the system. Then we say that when once there is a request from a process to a resource, and there can be an assignment edge from a resource to a process, both these type of edges can be there. So there can be a request edge and an assignment edge. A request edge is a directed edge, that is, from we have an edge PI to RJ. That means process PI is requesting an instance of resource type, resource R with the type RJ as the one. And next, assignment edge means it's a directed edge from, if you have a RJ to PI, that means what? An instance of the resource type RJ is allocated to process PI. So these two types of edges will be there, and two types of nodes will be there in your resource allocation graph. Now, in the resource allocation graph, the process will be represented by circles, and the resource will be represented in a square, or you can say rectangle. It can be a square, and you can have number of dots inside that one. If the number of dots inside that one represents the instances of that particular resource. Now, in this figure, we can see that this resource is having four instances, and PI request instance of RJ will be, there will be an edge between this process PI to an RJ, and PI is holding an instance of RJ means PI is being allocated an instance of RJ. So we will point from the dots to the corresponding dots. It is not from the resource type, it is the instance, from the instance to process you have to allocate. So this is an assignment edge, and this is a request edge for the inside your resource allocation graph. Okay. So we'll see an example of a resource allocation graph now. Now from the figure you can see that you have three processes, P1, P2 and P3. Resources R1, R2, R3 and R4. So the set of processes, set of resources, and R1 is having a single instance of the resource type. R2 is having two instances of the resource type R2. R3 is having single instance, and R4 is having three instances of resource type. So what are the process states? You say that process P1 is holding, or it is requesting a resource R1, and P1 is holding one resource, that is R2. From here, R2, an instance is allocated, or you can say that one instance of R2 is allocated to P1. So you can say that process P1 is holding an instance of resource type R2, and it is waiting for a instance of resource type R1. That is the state of P1. What about P2? P2 is holding an instance of, you see, the single instance R1, it is being assigned to P2. So P2 is holding one instance of R1 and it is waiting for R3 and another resource, that is R2, and one instance is assigned to P2. So you can say that P2 holds one instance of R1 and one instance of R2, and it is waiting for one instance of R3. That is the state of P2. And P3, regarding P3, P3 is holding one instance of R3 and it is not at all waiting for any other resources. Even though R4 is having three instances, among these processes, they haven't requested or they don't have any request for R4. So currently, all the three instances of this resource type R4 is currently free. So if there is any request, you can get into directly that one. But here it is, both these one is assigned to, one is assigned here, one is assigned here, and likewise the thing. So this is the example of a resource allocation graph. Okay. Now, how will you detect from this graph at a deadlock whether the system has a deadlock or not? You can say that if the graph contains a cycle, you know what is a cycle? Continuous one. If you have a cycle, then you can say that then deadlock may exist. Okay. Then if the graph contains no cycle, no process in the system is deadlock. And one more thing, if each resource type has exactly one instance, then a cycle implies a deadlock. That is, a cycle in a graph is both a necessary and a sufficient condition for the existence of a deadlock. So if you have the previous figure, it is having multiple instances, R2 is having multiple instances, but if it has only single instance and if you find a cycle in the graph, then you can say that deadlock will exist and the cycle in the graph is both a necessary and a sufficient condition for the existence of deadlock. Now, suppose each resource type has several instances, then a cycle does not necessarily imply deadlock. Then we cannot say that the system may get into a deadlock. The cycle doesn't guarantee that. You can say that it can be, it can or cannot be, it depends. So cycle in the graph is a necessary but not a sufficient condition for the existence of deadlock in the case of resource type with several instances. Clear? Now we'll see a resource allocation graph with the deadlock. Okay. Now suppose if from the previous problem or a previous figure, if there is a request from P3 to R2. Okay. So suppose P3 requests an instance of resource type R2. We know that already two instances of R2 is being allocated to P1 and P2. And there is a request from P3. So that means what? This P3 must wait. Okay. So no resource instances are currently available. We know that only two instances are there. And these two are allocated to P1 and P2. Okay. So P3 is in a, P3 doesn't have the resource. So it is coming into a waiting stage. Now you add a request edge P3 to R2 in the graph. Okay. Now you can see in this situation, after this request is being done, you see that there are two minimal cycles exist in the system. That is two cycles. We'll see. See, start from P1 to R1 and then to P2 and then to R3 and then to P3, come to R2 and then P1. So this way you can see a cycle is existing. Is it clear? One cycle. And one more cycle is there. P2 to R3 and R3 is assigned to P3 and P3 is requesting R2, which is assigned to P2. So you can see one more cycle here. So you can say that process P1, P2 and P3 are deadlocked, or they are in a deadlock situation. These processes are in a deadlock condition. Okay. Now we'll see a graph with a cycle but not deadlock. Even though there is a cycle, there is no deadlock. Okay. See the cycle. You take the cycle P1 to R1, and this situation we say that there are two instances of R1, two instances of R2, and you have process P1, P2, P3 and P4 are the processes inside the system, two resources. And when P1 is requesting for a resource R1, R1 in instances of R1 are already assigned to P2 and P3. So that means no instance is free, so that P1 is waiting. Now P3 is requesting for a resource, instance of a resource R2. But what happens? It has only two instances, and that is being allocated to P1 and P4. So you can see that there is a cycle here. P1 R to R1, request R1, and which is allocated to P3, and P3 is requesting R2, and R2 is allocated to P1. So you can see that there is a cycle. Okay. So whether there is a deadlock or not, we'll see. Now, you know that P3 is, if any one of the edges can be changed, that is, if it is a waiting edge, if it can be made as a assignment edge, you can, if there is a request and you say that it is not being allocated, you can say that it is only a request edge. When it comes to an allocation, you change that into an, which one? Allocation edge. That graph or the symbol goes from here. The arrow will be starting from one to this one. So if suppose at any P2 or some allocate, you can allocate R2 to P3. If suppose P4 is releasing, now you suppose that P4 completes and the P4 is releasing R2. So that means what? From hereafter, P4 doesn't need this R2 and it has released that resource. And if that is releasing, that resource can be allocated to P3. By that, we'll be able to break your, which one? The cycle can be break. So that means it can be, you don't have any more a cycle here, because it is coming as an assignment edge. So you cannot find a cycle. So that means if you have multiple instances, a cycle doesn't deal or end with a deadlock. Sometimes it may end with a deadlock, but there are situations where you can escape or you can be out from the deadlock situation. So this is a situation where a cycle is there, but there is no deadlock. So this is a case with the resources with multiple instances. Is that clear? So we can see some facts. If your graph contains no cycles, that means no deadlock. If your graph contains a cycle, and if only one instance per resource type, then deadlock occurs. And if the several instances per resource type, there is a possibility of deadlock, and sometimes it can be away from the deadlock also. You can be away from the deadlock. Okay. Now we'll see the methods for handling deadlocks. There are three ways. Even though we don't like deadlock situation be in your systems, sometimes if deadlock is occurring, how can you handle these deadlocks? There are three ways for handling your deadlock. The first one is, you make sure that your system will never enter into a deadlock situation. And this can be done by using a protocol to, or a algorithm or a method protocol to implement or to make deadlock prevention. That is, you prevent deadlock or you can avoid that job. Use any of the protocol and ensure that the system will never enter a deadlock situation. If you go for a prevention or if you go for an avoidance, you can say that the system will never enter into a deadlock situation. That is the first way. And the next one says that you allow the system to enter a deadlock state. That means if you are not going for any prevention or avoidance, sometimes the system may enter into a deadlock situation. Now, in that situation, you detect the deadlock and then go for a recovery method or recover from the deadlock situation. This is a second case for handling your deadlock. And third, you say that you ignore the problem that and pretend that deadlock will never occur in the system. You say that deadlocks are very rare, and so you assume that deadlocks will never occur in the system. And this is method or this third criteria is used by many of the operating systems, including your Linux and Windows. Okay, once if it is there, they will try to recover it from that one. Okay. Into a deadlock situation. So for that one, you can either go for a prevention method or for an avoidance method. First one, you will see the prevention. So we can prevent. So what you are doing is restrain the ways the request can be made. Or that means ensure that at least one of the necessary conditions cannot hold. You have said that where we know that there needs a four necessary conditions to simultaneously system so that you will be getting into a deadlock. So if you can make any one of the conditions to be a false one, then that means what? Your system will not get into a deadlock situation. So any one of the conditions can be made as a false. So that means you can avoid that one. So take the first one. Mutual exclusion is the first condition. If you are not going to satisfy this condition, then can you avoid the deadlock situation? Let us see. Now, you know that mutual exclusion means at least only one process can execute. If you are changing that situation, that means what? More than one process will be executing with a resource. Is that possible? In some cases, it is possible. That is, if it is not required for shareable resources. That is, if you have a file and if it is a read-only one, multiple processes can access that file. There is no problem. So, if you are making that thing okay, it is not a problem for that one. But the other case is, it must be for the non-shareable resources, this condition must hold. Why? Because suppose there is a printer, can two processes print simultaneously? What will happen? You cannot do it like that. So mutual exclusion is a necessary condition, or you cannot make this condition a false. If you are making that condition false, in the non-shareable cases, it will be a problem for that one. And also mutex locks, you know, with the semaphores and all, we have locks will be there. So from the entering into the critical section, you will be allowing a lock with that one, and a mutex locks or a semaphore will be there. So if two processes are simultaneously sharing that locks, what will happen? Critical section, you know that it can only execute, it can be executed only by one process. So you can say that you cannot prevent deadlocks by denying the mutual exclusion condition. Mutual exclusion condition must be there for non-shareable resources. So if you are preventing or if you are going for denying the mutual exclusion, we won't be able to prevent the deadlock. Is that clear? Next, you have the deadlock prevention by checking whether the hold and wait condition. By denying the hold and wait condition, can you guarantee that the processes will not will not get into a deadlock situation? So it hold and wait guarantees that a process requests a resource, it does not hold any other resources. The hold and wait condition means it hold one resource and it is waiting for the other one. So if such condition is not at all going to happen, that means what? It does not hold any other resources when it requests a new resource. So let us see the first protocol. So a process must request and be allocated all its resources before it begins the execution. So when a process wants to execute, and if it needs three resources, whatever resources it needs, R1, R2 and R3, that the three resources must be allocated initially to that process. Okay, so this can be implemented by requiring that system calls requesting resources for a process precede all other system calls. So initially all the resources which is needed by that process is allocated to that process itself. Okay, so take an example. You want to copy some data from a DVD to a file and you want to sort that file and finally you want to print it. So which all resources you need? You know the DVD is needed, the file is needed, and finally the printer is needed. So all resources must be requested at the beginning. Okay, all the three. So first what you are doing to do, you request all these three and it will be allocated. So in this case, even though the printer is needed only at the last, because after copying and sorting, then only you need the printer to print the content. So it is allocated from the beginning till the end. So what happens? It is a mere wastage or resource utilization is low. So that means this printer may be requested by some other process, and that process may be in the waiting state because this printer is allocated to P1. Even though printer is not at all needed by process, till the end it is being allocated from initial time itself. So this is the way we are going for. The protocol says that all the resources must be allocated to that process. And the second protocol, you can go for another way also. You can allow these processes to request the resources only when process allocated. That is, if a process is not having any resource that can be request for new number of or any number of resources. That is, hold and wait is not possible. Either it can go for, it cannot hold anything. It can go for at a time you request every resources which it needs. So a process may request some resources and use them. Now the request release or the new request, when there is a new request, if you have three resources R1, R2 and R3 and if you need a new R4, then release all resources currently allocated. What happens? R1, R2 and R3 must be released. Okay. And then only you can go for R4. This is the second protocol. Now here in this protocol, how you can go for the same problem? First, you need the DVD drive and the disk file only. Why? Because you are going to copy from DVD to the file. So you don't need the printer, so you are not at all requesting. Now after writing into the file, you are going to sort also. So after this thing, you will be releasing both the DVD and the disk. Both things are not at all needed, completed the task. So you are, it is not the exact completion. What you are doing with these two resources, the things are done. Then after that one, you need the disk file and the printer. Now you copy using the printer, you can print this one and finally releases these two resources and it terminates. But there is a problem that we'll see. When you are releasing the disk file, before getting these two file and printer to this particular process, some other process may take this file and can make some corrections into or some changes into that file, so that what file you have written might have been changed. So you cannot guarantee that this file will be intact for a print itself. So that is the problem. So there are two main disadvantages for these two types of protocols, resource utilization may be low. That you know that the printer will be with the process for a longer period of time. So that printer can, or this resource can be used by some other processes. And whenever you are releasing the DVD and the disc file, and again when you request a disc and printer, you must make sure that our data will remain on the disc file. Sometimes if in between some other process changes that file, that newly changed one will be printed, not our file will be printed because of the sharing. That is, you cannot do it. And starvation is possible. You know that when you have your printer assigned here, it will be, it cannot be used by other processes. So a process that needs several popular resources may have to wait indefinitely. This printer may be needed by a number of processes, and these processes may be waiting indefinitely. So at least one of the resources that it needs is always allocated to some other process. The next condition is no preemption. If a process that is holding some resource requests another resource that cannot be immediately allocated to it, then all resources currently being held are released. No preemption. You say that resources are implicitly released. Preempted resources are added to list of resources for which the process is waiting. See, from the preemption means no preemption means no other process can preempt any resource currently allocated process. If P1 is having a resource R1 and the resource R1 is needed by R2, P2, then P2 cannot immediately preempt that one. That is the case with no preemption. So if that condition must be denied, a process that is holding some resource, when it requests another resource and that request cannot be immediately allocated, then all the resources currently being held are released. So suppose R1, R2 and R3 is with P1, and P1 is requesting for some R1, what happens? This sometimes the R1, R2 and R3 can be preempted by a resource, another process. So preempted resources, these R1, R2 and R3 goes to the list of resources for which the process is waiting. And this process P1, it initially had R1 and R2. Okay, when it requests for some R3, what happened? That was not at all available, and this process was waiting in that waiting stage. So during that time, if some other process P2 needs these R1 and R2, what happens? That will be preempted from process P1. And when, so now P1 doesn't have anything. P1 initially had R1 and R2, and when it requested for R3, what, it was not available. So P1 gets into a waiting stage. P1 only has R1 and R2. And another P2, when it requests for this R1, what happened? You can say that these two will also be preempted because it is already in the waiting stage. So there is no need to complete. So you see that with that information or with that resource, it cannot complete. So it has to gain all the old resources plus the newly one which is requesting. Okay. So if you have a process and it requests some resources, first check whether they are available. If they are, allocate them. And if they are not available, check whether they are allocated to some other process that is waiting for additional resources. Now, in that case, preempt the desired resources from the waiting process and allocate them to the requesting process. And if the resources are neither available nor held by a waiting process, then the requesting process must wait. During the waiting, some of its resources may be preempted, but only if another process requests them. That is, if another process is requesting a resource which is held by a waiting process, and then that allocate a process resources also will be preempted from that one. Okay. So a process can be restarted only when it is allocated the new resources it is requesting and recovers resources that were preempted while it was waiting. So these type of protocols can be applied to resources whose state can be easily saved and restored later. So CPU registers and memory space, and it cannot be applied to resources with that for the mutex locks and semaphores. That is, it cannot be state cannot be saved easily and it cannot be restored. So that means this can be applied to only these type of resources only. Next comes the circular wait. If you want to deny this particular one, you impose a total ordering of all resource types and require that each process requests resources in an increasing order of enumeration. That means, suppose that R is a resource, set of resources, R1, R2, etc., Rm be the set of resources. You assign a unique integer with the resource type. That is, you have R1 can be assigned to 1, R2 can be assigned to 2, like that integers can be assigned to these resources, and whether so that we can go for whether the these resources are coming in a particular order, whether R1 comes first or R2 comes next, like that you can go for a comparison of resources. That means you define a one-to-one function, a function from R to N, where N is the set of natural numbers. Now, set of resource types are, you can say that number of resources are there, tape drives, disk drives, printers, like these are, suppose these three are the resources we are dealing with. Then a function can be defined as follows. F of tape drive, that is equal to 1, means the value assigned for this tape drive function will be 1. And f of disk drive is equal to 5 and f of printer is equal to 12. In that case, what can, in a word order you can request the resources. That you say that each process can request resources only in an increasing order of enumeration. That is, if you are requesting for resource 1, then you can request for 5. But when you request 5, you can thereafter you cannot go for 1 or the number which is less than that one. So in the previous one, if you are initially requesting for 5, then you can request for 12 after that one. You cannot go for 1, okay, because it is number is less than 5, so you cannot request. So if you want to request this one, initially request this one, then 5 and 12. So if suppose by any chance you are requesting 12, then you cannot request these two without withholding this one. If you are releasing this one, you can in some time you can request for a lesser ones. So a process can initially request any number of instances of a resource type Ri. You can request for any number of instances. Then the process can request instances of resource type Rj. After Ri, you can go for any Rj if and only if this Rj is greater than f of Ri. We are having initially Ri, after that you're going to request Rj, and this request can be made possible if only this f of Rj is greater than f of Ri. So process requesting an instance of resource type Rj must have released any resources Ri such that f of Ri is greater than or equal to f of Rj. So if you are requesting for instance of Rj, it must have released any resources Ri. Okay, when you are saying that with the number with that one must be released. So that is, if you are having, if you have 12 and you want to request that 5, what happens? You must release that 12. Then only you will be able to request that 5. So with the help of or with execute with your with 12, you cannot request for 5. So if you want, what you have to do, you release your 12 and then request 5. This is the method. So this is the ordering you are going. So several instances of same resource type, if you want, then a single request for all of them can be issued. So with using these two protocols, the circular condition cannot hold. You can say that there must be a total ordering, and if you want to request for RJ with holding RI, this RJ must be greater than F of RI. And if you want to request RJ, this RJ must be, or F of RI must be greater than or equal to F of RJ. So if you are using these two protocols, the circular wait condition cannot hold.
Ma'am.
Okay. Deadlock prevention is completed. So the proof of that one was in April. Can I go for another 5 minutes or some time? Because one more proof of that one, the previous one, I want to complete. Can I help?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. So the circular wait condition. You're saying that you will be able to, if you want to deny the circular wait condition, you have an order or a process like this, so that we can stop, or you can circular wait condition will not hold. So how this is made possible? Now assume that there is a circular wait, it is existing in your system, okay, and the set of process involved in the circular wait is P0, P1, etc., PN. These are the processes which are involved in the circular wait. And that is, PI is waiting for a resource RI, which is held by PI plus 1. Okay. And PI plus 1, it is waiting for a resource RI plus 1, which is held by PI plus 2. Likewise, PN is waiting for a resource RN, which is held by P0. That is, a circular wait is being there in the system. So that means PI plus 1 is holding RI while requesting the resource RI plus 1. So you can say that F of RI is less than F of RI plus 1 for all I. Okay. That is, the value of this function is less than the value with I plus 1 to resource. So this condition means when you give, if you put I equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, etc., you say that F of R 0 is less than F of, I is given as 0. So I plus 1, F of R 1. So F of R 0 is less than F of R 1, which is less than F of R 2, which is less than F of R 3. Likewise, it is F of N minus 1 is less than F of R n. And finally, as you are having a circular wait, you say that F of Rn is less than F of R0. You can say that by transitivity, F of R0 is less than F of R0. So is that condition true? It is not possible. If you have equals, then it is okay. But it is not like that. It is less than symbol only. So you can say that with the transitivity, F of R0 is less than F of R0, which is impossible. So therefore, there can be no circular wait. So this ordering or hide, we are having an ordering, that is, it can request resources in a higher order, or you say that if low number resource number is requested, then you can go for the higher order. So the ordering or this hierarchy does not itself actually prevent deadlock. You can say the application developers must write programs that follow the ordering. You must write it in that way, and you must define a function according to the normal order of usage of the resources inside a system. We know that. That is, if you are putting in the previous one, we are putting tape drive, disk drive is equal to 5 and printer is equal to, or printer is given the number 12. That means this is a normal one. We need some drive before the printer, no? Finally, only you'll be using the printer. So if you are putting the printer number as a smaller one, it is not like that. So you have to put it the 5 as a normal one. This must be in an order. Okay. So that is the four conditions. That means the prevention is finished.
We have one question, relevant one. The question is, what are the reasons for deadlock after using scheduling algorithm?
Okay, scheduling algorithm means one by one processes are being scheduled into the system. So one will be executing, only one. But the thing is, if you have cooperating processes, you can say that process will be affecting each other. So if two processes comes into the situation and if it is accessing two resources simultaneously, then sometimes you may have you just take the case of a printer. Okay, from one process is reading one file and another process and this process is printing that one, and another process B also needs this printer. And if by any chance P1 is in wait of a resource which is held by P2, what will happen? P2 is waiting for that process P1 to complete the printing, is it? And the printer is held with P1. What happens? P1 cannot complete. Why? Because it needs some resource held by process P2. You just suppose there is some critical section of something, some file which is, or some details which is held by P2. So with the release of that resource, P1 can only complete and the printer is held there. That's it. And this situation can be reversed also. P2 may be having the printer and the other one cannot execute because of the resource held by other. So this is a situation. Multiple processes are working inside your system. So the cooperating process will be making such a problem. And for that one, you're dealing with some synchronization problems, semaphores, mutex locks and all. So you must be sure that you can see that the sections previously said the producer-consumer problem and all. The producer and consumer simultaneously, when it accesses that variable, semaphore variable, how they are going to do that one. So in that situation, deadlock. So it is a software or the programmers must deal with that one. Okay. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am. It was the only question we had in the Q&A section. Thank you, ma'am. Okay. That was indeed an informative session. We are grateful for the time and effort you took to share your knowledge with our students. We are expecting a cooperation for future ventures of SAP also. I would also like to thank the participants for investing your time for the session and expecting your participation in upcoming sessions also. Thank you all once again. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you, students. And all the best for your exams. You will, if there is any doubts regarding this section, you can contact me. Feel free to contact me. It's not a problem for me. We are here to help you.